So kia ora tato, it's a real honour to be here and to stand here in front of you, and I'm glad the bio wasn't read out. Perhaps I want to add my sense of being really inspired by the last presentation, the wisdom that was shared, the challenges that were put out, and I really hope that as I stand here in a privileged position to talk to you about a resource that I hope can help with longitudinal studies, but also life course research in New Zealand, that you can also maybe take up some of the challenges of coming and engaging with this resource and helping us to use it in a way that will improve the well-being of all of our New Zealanders, which I think is really what drives us all. So, okay, is this the clicker? Green button, okay, no, the big green button, aha, thank you. So that was the first technological challenge that I failed. I'm just a girl from Taranaki, to build on the last talk as well, and technology is not my strength, but I will come back to technology when we talk about that in terms of this cohort. So look, what I thought I'd do with the brief time that I have with you this afternoon is to really just introduce you to this resource that is the contemporary longitudinal study called Growing Up in New Zealand. And it was charged on behalf of 16 government agencies and New Zealanders to provide population-relevant evidence that could actually improve the well-being of all of our current generation of New Zealand children. And it really recognised that we have some shameful statistics for our population as a whole, but perhaps most importantly for the inequities that we see within our population. And that despite the fact that we may know a lot about human development, we don't necessarily know what to do to improve it very well, and we haven't done very well at that over the last few decades. And so really this study was set up with the desire to collect information to help us try and address some of those entrenched problems. When we set this study up, I'd recently been lucky enough to be in the UK, who of course do have a rich history, as well as our Dunedin and Christchurch studies, for doing longitudinal research. And at the same time as we were setting this up, the whole DOHAD field, Developmental Origins of Health and Disease, was set up. But what I wanted to talk to you about really is the lens that I think I tried to bring and others in the team tried to bring to the framework that was set up to guide this new study, and that was very much a life course framework. And that life course framework really grew out of dissent between the DOHADers, if you like, and the adult cardiovascular physicians and epidemiologists who seemed to think that what we were talking about with life course was some sort of only focus on an early start, when life course tried to actually say development is actually shaped intergenerationally across time at all points in time, and every time point is important. So it is kind of timely to be here to bring challenges together and think about life course in that way. And when I think about life course, I also draw on John Lynch, who we heard from Tony Blakely before about, as well as some other key academics worldwide, who really designed or set out what a life course framework was about. And I think we quite often focus on the lower half of that framework that sits there. We ignore quite often the things that sit above the red line, if you like. We talk about them a lot. We talk about the social determinants of health. We talk about the social disadvantage. We talk about the gradients that we see according to social disadvantage or social class in the UK system. But actually, we don't necessarily take enough account of it as we manage our data analyses, whatever data we're looking at. And we don't often think about it enough in terms of its complexity as it impacts on an individual's life course in their lifetime, but also across generations. And so I want to try and give you a few examples of where I hope we have tried to do that in terms of using the data and the resource that we've been collecting over the last 10 years now from the Growing Up in New Zealand children. And integral to that, we'll be thinking about the time dimension, so time is really important, but also thinking about trajectories rather than just risk factors, thinking about covariates rather than just controlling for confounders, and actually thinking about how we events cluster and accumulate over time and how things occur, not in silos, but actually are all interrelated. So the Growing Up in New Zealand cohort, for those of you that don't know, and I'm not going to spend very long on this because I assume you do, has nearly 7,000 children, so a lot bigger than our earlier studies, but not big compared to international studies. It recruited in pregnancy, which was a nod to the fact that actually pregnancy was important for shaping well-being and that intergenerational continuity was important for the life course of any child being born. It also recruited partners from the beginning, so dads were seen as important too. They were recruited from pregnancy and continue to be important voices in these studies. The cohort size and diversity, really importantly, is of key interest in New Zealand because it actually is important that we understand our current diverse population. So 1 in 4 of the children is expected to identify as Māori by one or both of their parents, 1 in 5 as Pacifica, 1 in 6 as New Zealand Asian, and actually 2/3 still as New Zealand European, which means almost half the children are expected to have multiple identities, and we do not expect that those identities will be fixed, nor that the children will agree with what their parents said their ethnic identity would be. So that's just a challenge that runs through all the analyses that we undertake in this study. The population of interest was all births, and that is a representation of where we're going in the future. We are a very different group going forward than we have been in the past, and so that diversity is important to understand how we can improve the well-being for all of these children. So we applied this life course approach, the one that we stole from Lynch and from others and Bron from Brenner and many other eminent people who'd thought about the way that children develop, not in a silo and not in a vacuum, but in dynamic interaction with all of the environments around them, starting with their family, and those families are very diverse in this generation, but also all the way out to the formal, the informal social networks and the policy environment. And our goal was at every point that we connected with these families and children to actually capture each of those rings of influence on the children, to understand how not only the children were changing and developing, but how those environments around them were changing as well, and how those things interacted over time. So that was the sort of life course approach that we applied to the framework. And what I hope to show you is what we've tried to do with some of the analyses that respect that sort of life course approach to try and then find new solutions, really, to deal with some of the problems that we know are entrenched for our children and for our population generally. So I just want to give you a quick sort of overview of some of the things that we found in the first 5 years. The children are 8. We're currently in the field with the 8-year data collection wave. The last data collection wave was when they were 4.5. So I'm just going to focus on that preschool information so far and give you a few insights into how I hope we have started to try and use this information alongside communities to actually find new solutions to improve well-being for our children. So the first thing to say is that these are photos of children in the cohort. Normally we don't identify them, but there are a few who have allowed us to use the images. And that's really important because these are real children and these are real families, and it's really important that we honour them in that way. And this is to remind me that actually, while we focus on the mad and the sad and the bad, most of our children are thriving. The idea of the 70%, 20%, 10% that we heard about from Judge B. Croft is very true, and we see that in the statistics for these children as well. But there are around 10% of our children who are persistently not thriving, and around 20% who are close to being in that category. This one also reminds me that we look at the ECE journeys of these children all the way from birth through to 5. We know that by the time they start school, 97% of them have been exposed to an ECE environment. That's up from 60% when they were 2 and up from 30% at 9 months in some form of care. We're also very interested in the gap that often exists between policy and the family. And one of the things that we look at is service use. Are the services that are currently out there targeted to improve well-being of children actually reaching the families and the children they're supposed to reach? So one of the things that we've looked at is, for example, the interaction with the free oral health check, as well as the interaction with the well child checks, and I'll talk to you about that shortly. But importantly, it's not just about cost, and it's not just about information. So one of the things we can do with a longitudinal study, which I think is exciting and can add value to some of our admin data, is we can ask about barriers and enablers, and we can ask about choice. And so when we ask about some of the interaction with services, we find that particularly our Māori and Pacific children are underrepresented in some of those free services and some of those universal services. They're also underrepresented in our well child statistics, which means they're underrepresented in the big data we're using to make policy about our young children, and that's a problem. As someone spoke about earlier, I think, Andrew, we may in fact be widening inequalities if we don't listen to those most vulnerable children. We look at behaviour in this study as well, and we look at bullying. So we heard about bullying before. We know it's a problem for our adolescents. We know it's actually a problem in adulthood as well. But what we were surprised to find is that children were being bullied in their preschool years. So 10% persistently reported as being bullied by their parents between the ages of 2 and 4. And at 4.5, 1 in 3 children reported as being bullied. Now, at the moment, that's the mum's voice telling us that, and we're very interested to hear the children's views of that and how they feel about that at 8, and they will tell us themselves. But those behaviours seem to start quite early in our population. Something else that we're also able to do by tracking families and children, the same ones over time, is to look at the health and well-being of the parents, or those who are caring for the children. And importantly, we can look, for example, at the mental well-being of the mums and dads, and we do see rates of depressive symptoms that are far too high in both our mums and our dads in pregnancy, and then they go on into postnatal life. And that does have impact on the children's well-being. We see that dads also get the blues more than men of the same age in the population, and that's a concern as well. Men tend to be more depressed postnatally than during the pregnancy period, whereas for mums it's the other way around. And if mum's depressed, that's really bad for dad, and if dad's depressed, it doesn't seem to matter to mum. I'm sure it matters to the child. Make of that what you wish. We're also really interested in the dynamics of the families, the households that sit around these families, these children, because they don't develop in isolation. So we're constantly looking at who's in the household, how that family structure is changing. We don't need to impute what the household is. We know who is in the house and how that changes over time, and it changes pretty rapidly. One of the things we heard about before was young mums, and we certainly have around 5% of those, and sole parents. But actually, sole parents in this generation are quite rare. 1 in 20 of the children has only one parent, usually mum, in the first 5 years. But actually, 1 in 4 of the children is living in an extended family situation. So there are other people we can be thinking about when we're thinking about the well-being of the children, beyond just thinking that it's all mum's job, or even just mums and dads. So let me pick on a couple of things that I just want to illustrate some of the ways that we've tried to use this information in a life course way, and potentially collected information that can even be used further to understand what's going on for our children and find new solutions. I think the first one relates to the fact that within a longitudinal study, we can look at churn. We can look at change in circumstance over time, and change is remarkably rapid. So here's just one or two examples in this case of deprivation, area level deprivation, measured antenatally and at 9 months, 12 months apart. And if you look at the absolute figures, you'll see that at antenatal period and 9 months, it looks like about the same number of families are impacted by being in that most deprived quintile. But actually what we miss from that, if we only take the cross-sectional measure, is the rate of change, the movement in and out. And understanding what has led to that movement, particularly out of disadvantage, is really, really important. And that's what we can glean from some of the stories that the families share with us. Similarly, depression, while it goes down for mums, we actually have most of the mums resolving and half the cases being new. So we can't assume that one is a subset of the other. Similarly, when we look at outcomes, I think we have to be very careful about how we use this information to inform new strategies. So here's a summary slide that just looks at, for example, child behaviour. A lot of information now about child behaviour, particularly self-control, and this magic age of 3, because we've measured that at 3 before. But when we measured at 2 and 4.5 in this new study, we actually find, yes, 10 or 11% of the children at both time points are in the abnormal category of behaviour and actually demonstrating poorer self-control. But actually more than half of those children have changed between those two time periods. So we have to be very careful about when we label and when we intervene and how we support all of these children to actually do better. Mobility is a huge issue for this generation of children. They are residentially mobile. So 2 out of 3 of all the children have moved home at least once in their first 5 years of life. Some 10% have moved 2 or more times, and a small number have moved more than 12 times. This is a huge challenge for services. It's a huge challenge for us, because we have to find these children and families when we want to engage with them and hear their stories. And the ones that are most likely to move are the most insecure and the most vulnerable, but by no means is it universal. Some movement is actually for advancement or for good reasons. But primarily the major driver is in and out of private rental properties for these families, and 50% of them, or just under 50%, are renters, and likely to remain that way if the statistics stay this way as they have in the first 6-7 years of the study. And we've demonstrated that actually that's associated with a less safe environment for children who are in private rentals. And that has been part of the evidence that we provided for the warrant of fitness that's now going through in terms of landlords needing to provide safer environments for all of our children and families, given the proportion who will grow up in that sort of environment. Things like working smoke alarms, driveway fences, things that we know contribute to some of the poor statistics we see for our children. Child obesity has been a big focus, no pun intended, and obviously part of our National Science Challenge focus in working with the Better Start. And while we look at the big data and see that trends seem to be that the rate in 4.5-year-olds might be going down slightly, when we look at this cohort over time, the same children, we're actually seeing rates increasing. So I think it's important to think about the complementarity of that piece of information, and not to assume because we see something from the big data that that's what's happening at the level of the individuals over time. And the other part of this slide is to say that just because we measure children as being overweight or obese, and we think there's a problem if we're clinicians or if we're advising parents about what to do, actually, if parents don't recognise there's a problem, then we're going to have a barrier for a start. And only 1 in 3 of the parents of children who measured overweight or obese at 4.5 actually recognised that there was any problem with their children. In fact, they were most concerned about their children being happy and healthy and having good well-being, and obesity was the least of their concerns. So that's just a brief snapshot. I just want to move into thinking about some of the ways that I think all of us are challenged in terms of providing evidence to actually inform change, things that can make a difference for our children now and for our children into the future, and ultimately for all of us. And I think we've heard this a few times today, but it's something I want to come back to. We need to move beyond risk factorology. We need to move beyond the idea that just because we understand very well the risk factors that are associated with outcomes, that we know what to do about a problem. Just dealing with the risk factors on their own may be necessary, but it's not sufficient to change the conditions necessarily at a population level. And a life course approach asks us to consider more than just risk factors. It prompts us to say why. What's working? What's happening across multiple disciplines? What's happening across time? And what's happening in terms of comorbidities? Because things for children tend to cluster and don't occur on their own, which can be a good thing, because if we can make change, maybe we're going to have an effect that goes beyond a single silo. So here's just a couple of examples to try and show you how we think about that, and potentially to give you some ideas about how you might use this resource to think about it too. When we look at screen time, which we've heard about today, we heard about TV time for our children, we absolutely see there is an association between hours of watching screens and obesity and poor behaviour and pretty much any outcome you might think about. And so we could say, okay, reduce screen time. And that has been a message that's gone out there, and it's probably a good message. However, in an age of digital natives, when children are going to be using screens probably for the rest of their life, when you give that message to parents, it's maybe not so useful. So when we dig beneath and use the information from the families, we find that actually it's not the hours of screen time that causes the association. It's actually about whether there are rules and whether those rules are being enforced. And when you put into the equation, if you like, whether there are rules in the home around screen time, content, time, who's round with the child, how often they're watching, and so on, and you add that to the equation, then you find that the association disappears. And there's a message you can give to parents. You can say it's about having rules around those and enforcing them. And the same is actually true with sleep. routine sleep times, regular sleep times, seems to be the issue when we think about the association between sleep and obesity when we look at the data from the study. I just want to touch on something that's a little bit more complex but is really, really important. And we've heard about disadvantage a lot, or vulnerability, or child poverty, and there are lots of ways that we can describe it. I think all of us would probably agree that poverty is a really complex issue to measure. It also creates a complex environment for children and for families. And the way we try and think about it is actually not just income-based, not just based on one or two measures of deprivation, but actually a whole cluster of factors, because these factors cluster in different ways for different families. But a little bit like some of the evidence we saw earlier, if families are routinely exposed to any four or more of these 12 factors, they are highly vulnerable. And I'll show you what I mean by that in the next couple of slides. If they're exposed to none of them, they're not very vulnerable at all. And if they're somewhere in the middle, then they have a medium-term exposure. What do I mean by that? Well, when we look at that sort of idea of persistent exposure over time, so this is antenatal 9 months, 2 years, over the first 1,000 days, and we look at what that means for virtually any outcome at 4.5, and here I've just shown you obesity, and the next slide will show you behaviour, we see this impact of persistent poverty, which is no great surprise maybe, but here's the evidence to show that it really does matter, that early life matters. Time of exposure matters, the time being exposed matters in terms of persistence. And actually, there are a couple of good news messages in this too, I think, even though it looks like a horrible slide. The first thing is it's very graded, this effect. So if we can remove some of those risk factors, we may well reduce the risks for these children of having poor outcomes. But the second thing that we see, and I'll show you on behaviour, because I could show you this with multiple outcomes, then if we look at the behaviour slide, I think there's something even more interesting, and that is that those children in the most vulnerable environments between pregnancy and 2 years who are exposed to four or more of those deprivation factors at all those time points have an almost 1 in 2 chance of having poor behaviour by the time they're 4.5. They're less ready for school, they're more likely to be obese, they have more admissions to hospital, pretty much any outcome you can think of. But 56% of them don't. So there are a group of children who are exposed to this adversity who are not developing that. And that's really something that drives the work that we try and do with this information. We try and get beneath this risk factors and this association, even if it's graded in life course, and say what's working for those families, what's working for the 56% of children, while we deal with all the risk factors, what's working for them to actually keep them resilient in the face of those challenges. And that moves us beneath this idea of just thinking about the risk factors, so we want to know what's working. So we did that in South Auckland. That's an area that has some of the most deprived families and therefore children in the country. And we know that they are much more likely to be deprived by any particular metric that we use. So we went to the communities with these findings, with the findings around vulnerability, as well as potentially the fact that half of them were more resilient. And we said, how can we work with you? How do you want to use this information that you have shared with us to turn this into strategies to support your children? And what we looked for were protective factors, not the risk factors, but what was going on for the 56% that was different than the 44%. And what was going on was perhaps no great surprise, but it was connectivity. It was belonging. It was support from the community. It was having an environment that was safe for families to gather in and to share stories and support each other. And it turned into a collaborative project in South Auckland, based in libraries, that's a very noisy place now, where children and families are actually sharing and belonging and coming together to actually support each other, to create resilience that, in the face of these risk factors, can hopefully improve well-being for their children while these risk factors continue to be tackled. It's not a substitute for doing something about the risk factors, but it's a recognition that some of those risk factors are going to take a very long time to deal with. So what can we do in the meantime to support these families and children in the best possible way we can using the evidence? And I just want to conclude, because I can see I need to, that also one of the things that I said we like to do and we try and do with these families is to understand about real need. Because we're talking to families and children, we can measure the need of children and families in many, many ways. And then we can look at whether they interact with services or not. And unfortunately, when we do that, we see an inverse gradient. Okay, it's not a surprise, but we see it starkly. And we see that those who are most vulnerable are the ones who are least likely to engage with the current services. The ones who are most advantaged engage easily, and the ones in the middle engage pretty well. So universal strategies are not the answer on their own, as we've heard as well. We need to think about ways to engage these children who are missing out. And they're missing out in all sorts of ways, including the well child check, including the before school check, including readiness for school, and so on. So, my title was called Extraordinary Things Can Emerge from Following Ordinary Lives. That's not my idea. That's someone wonderful called Helen Pearson. And if you haven't read her book, The Life Project, I strongly encourage it. It's a wonderful read. She does talk about extraordinary things emerging from following ordinary people's lives. And I think that's because we can understand change. We can understand churn. We can understand, importantly, what creates choice. And most importantly, perhaps, we can hear voices. We can hear the voices of the families, the parents, and increasingly, as the children turn 8, we can hear the voices of the children themselves. And that is going to provide a rich resource, hopefully, to do something to make a difference for all of our children and all of our families. So I think it's perhaps no... I don't know whether it's a surprise or not, but it's interesting that we chose the same picture to have on our acknowledgement slide, Moana. This is one that I've been using for a while. I think it's really, really important, and that proverb that you put alongside it is critically important in terms of being looking after our children and looking after what they see and what they hear and what they see and understand and engage with, because they are our future, and they are our future, and that's what drives us all. So I can't give this talk without saying I'm privileged to stand here. I am female, I am pale, there's not much I can do about that. But we can all contribute, I think, to changing the situation for our current generation of children, and that's what I hope we're all driven to do. So thank you for listening.